Hello everyone, it has been a while since my last video on this channel. I apologize for that. I've been back at work and also dealing with some computer problems, and I know I've been sort of radio silent for the past month or two, and I'm hoping to change that. So hopefully to kick things back off a little bit, I have a review of a new movie that came out back in August, and is actually one of the highest grossing movies of this year already, being the first major successful blockbuster in China following their lockdown from the pandemic. And it is a historical war epic from sixth-generation director Guan Hu called The 800. The 800 depicts the defense of the Sihang warehouse, I think I'm saying that right, I don't really know, in Shanghai in 1937 during the Second Sino-Japanese War, the true start of World War II, really, wherein the admittedly embellished number of 800 soldiers at the request of the leader of the Kuomintang army hunkered down and defended the warehouse as a last refuge before the Japanese Imperial Army overtook Shanghai. This battle takes place right along a creek across which is the pristine upper-class concession area of the city under the management of the American and British militaries, the denizens of which, over the course of the film, go from passive onlookers to active supporters of the warehouse fight. So I was sent a screener for this film, and I had heard nothing about it, hadn't seen a trailer or anything, so I did not know much of what to expect going into it. I also don't watch too many modern Chinese blockbusters, although I've seen a good number of Chinese films more generally. I also only have a cursory understanding of the greater historical and political context of the events depicted in the film and of the film itself, so I will have pretty little to say about it on that front, unfortunately. I can't really comment on the politics of the film or of the historical accuracy of the film's events with any authority behind my voice, so I'm basically not going to, although I have not heard anything from what I've read about the Japanese hitting civilians in the concessions during their air attack, as they do in the film, but I don't know. I've also heard this movie be described by some people as Chinese war propaganda, and in several ways you could make that argument, but I don't think it is really in any way more egregious than something like American Sniper or 13 Hours in the US. I was certainly interested in how the film would humanize the army of the KMT, the pretty brutal nationalist party of the Republic of China. And while its critique of the ideology of the KMT, at least as it pertains to its military rank and file and those caught in its path, is kind of muted, I ended up being pretty surprised at the nuance in the presentation of the different players involved, at least from my perspective. Except the Japanese, of course. The human drama behind their motivations and actions is pretty much entirely ignored. Their position as the aggressor is just, you know, the grease that keeps the gears of the story turning. And yeah, I don't really have a problem with that. For the movie's goals, it works out pretty well. Speaking of human drama, though, there are a lot of memorable moments and good performances in this film, which, despite only taking place over the course of a few days, is a true epic, especially regarding its number of characters. There are a couple of characters that you could probably argue are the protagonists, but the film is mostly just threading together the lives of a number of people, and this, you know, a good part of this is that it provides all these good dramatic moments, and really allows the film to take a very varied and, you know, multi-perspective take on the event. But it also leaves a lot of the more principal characters feeling underdeveloped or non-specific, at least on my first watch. Lots of scenes have the texture and gravitas of poignant human moments, but just not always with all of the narrative foundation under it. Still, I think it overall treats its subject matter with a real interest in the human condition, and some scenes do break through the mold of the sort of played out war movie tropes, some of which are in this movie and are in a lot of movies similar to this one. From an aesthetic perspective, this film reminded me in many ways of like a Marvel movie, but mixed with like a Chris Nolan movie, kind of. The score by Hollywood composer Rupert Gregson-Williams, the use of intricate long takes reminiscent of something like Children of Men, the occasional use of slow-mo, the ear-rattling sound design, and just the general pacing and emotion behind most of the sequences bring to mind a lot of successful American blockbusters of the last 5 to 10 years. The ones that are considered a little bit more auteur-ish than maybe, you know, your average run-of-the-mill Marvel movie, but even then, in like the broad strokes, you know, there are a lot of aesthetic similarities to those types of movies. The one most unsurprisingly and frequently compared to being Dunkirk. And while this film isn't as lean or non-linear as that one, they do both share an aesthetic interest in putting the viewer in the action and using all the sophisticated tools of modern blockbuster filmmaking toward that goal. In this film's case, that mostly means CGI, although an impressive amount of it is in camera, and I can forgive the predictable use of CGI rather than real blood squibs and gun blanks here, because I imagine quite a bit of the film's resources went toward making the huge, nearly life-size set of the warehouse where most of the action takes place. The movie's battle sequences are, for the most part, very kinetic and exciting and well put together, and it is where this aesthetic sensibility shines the most. It's in some of the human moments that this tendency, this kind of Chris Nolan-y blockbustery tendency with, and I'm speaking specifically with aesthetics, and I'm sorry if I'm being vague, because it is a kind of broad type of movie that I'm comparing it to. In those moments, those aesthetic sensibilities don't always pay off, but in the battle sequences, that is where it really starts to come together more. I'm generally not a fan of this type of gritty, sort of washed out look for movies, but this film has enough flares of auteurism and interesting uses of its technology and interesting uses of these filmmaking techniques that we see a lot in these types of movies, like the long shots, for instance. And there's enough of that for it to stand above more mediocre films that use these types of things. This is also the first Chinese film to be shot entirely on IMAX cameras, and even though I watched this movie on a 23-inch computer screen with a watermark in the upper corner, it does still look great on those cameras, and the sound design is very detailed, and I want to avoid using the term immersive, but it just has lots of good, crispy, crunchy sounds, if you're into that sort of thing. That's all I really have to say about The 800. Like I said, I'm a dumb American baby, so I don't have any cool hot takes about this movie's treatment of the material or whatever. War movies also aren't really my favorite thing in the world, but I found this one to be, you know, pretty entertaining, pretty fairly engaging, mostly in the first two-thirds, and some parts to be pretty emotionally affecting. I actually think this could potentially be a pretty successful movie in theaters in America from a purely aesthetic and experiential standpoint. But there is a lot of anti-Chinese sentiment at the moment, so I'm not sure a film about this story specifically would really resonate or generate all that much interest stateside, but in terms of, like, how the movie feels to watch, I feel like Nolan heads and, like, DC fans should be, like, all over this. So yeah, not everything about it is my cup of tea, but it still seems to have, like, an actual artistic vision and isn't just a completely cold and soulless blockbuster. And while I would have liked some things to be a bit more fleshed out, I would still say it's worth watching. I'm gonna give The 800 a 6 out of 10. I'm not sure what the release situation with this movie is, like if they're gonna put it on a streaming service, or release it in theaters in the US, or what. Or if I should even be recommending that people go to a movie theater to see it right now at all, because God knows I haven't been going. So, but if you ever get the chance, I recommend you check it out. I'd like to see what other people think of it, especially someone who maybe has actually a bit of knowledge on the, you know, historical and political context of everything in it and the film itself. So I will have some more reviews for you soon. I also hopefully will have a Let's Watch for you within the coming weeks as well, but as I said, I have been dealing with some computer issues and other general life things to attend to, so do be patient. But thank you as always for watching, and I will see you all next time.